Hello, Steve Ramsden here with DIY Movie Making, and this week we are having another go at recreating the famous Mission Impossible mask effect. This video is sponsored by ArtGrid, royalty-free stock footage for filmmakers. So, it's that time again. To celebrate a new Mission Impossible film coming out, we've had another try at the famous mask effect.
Masks!
This is the moment that appears in most of the films where one character is suddenly revealed to be another, by pulling off a truly impossibly detailed mask, which is of course played by another actor. The fun you can have as a filmmaker is how to join these two actors' performances together seamlessly, and I'm going to show you how to create this type of shot on a budget. Just like I teach in my course, DIY Movie Making, you don't always need a lot of money to get some really creative shots. I'm always looking for new ways to do a lot with a little to really add some production value to my film projects, and if you want to see lots more fun DIY movie making tips and tricks, then of course hit that subscribe button. So looking at the Mission Impossible films, there is always a person 1 who is supposedly the mask, and a person 2 who is wearing the mask. But there seem to be two main ways this effect is done. Sometimes it is probably just the face of person 1 tracked onto person 2 who is already there, and other times it is the whole body which changes while you are busy looking at the face, and a few visible morphs in the clothing usually give this away. Now we've tried this effect twice before, attempting both methods. First a basic test where person 1's face is simply added on top of person 2 and then disappears as the mask comes off, and then secondly a full swap between heads and bodies of person 1 and 2. But this time we've tried to improve it even further and have done a few things differently. As before with this effect, you need two people, ideally the same height and eye colour. Both should wear the same costume, and we have found that something dark with a high neckline, like a turtleneck jumper, is a good choice because anything without much details and which hides the neck makes the whole thing easier. You also need consistent lighting, as any changes between takes will give away your joins. The only main prop you need is a rubber mask like this one, which is what we used, and we actually cut part of the neck off it in order to allow it to be removed with one hand more easily. This is also the first time we have added a wig to the mask to make it a better match with person 1. It's only for a few frames, but seeing some hair when the mask comes off really helps to sell the effect, and you see that they do this in the films. Now in the past, we've always tried this effect with a green or blue screen, and although this makes it easier to use the heads and bodies independently without locking you into a background, it has never produced great edges, especially around the hair. So this time we tried it with no green screen and planned to use rotoscoping to cut out the figures and add the clean background behind. We've also always tried this effect in the past with a static camera, and just for an extra challenge, this time we tried it with a moving camera, which you can see in some of the films, including this shot from Rogue Nation, which is the shot we have attempted to copy for this effect. This will likely have been done filming multiple passes using a motion control rig, but we used our DIY method of a manual slider set on a very slight incline, which means you can use gravity to let the camera slide down the rail and get a very similar shot every time. And if you want to see another fun experiment using this DIY motion control method, then check out my video on creating a clone effect using a moving camera. Having a moving camera is totally not necessary, but I wanted to try it this time to make the effect even slicker. So with our equipment set up, we began by filming person 1 doing a move as if pulling off the mask. The person needs to bring their hand up to the opposite earlobe and then pretend to pull a mask off. This covers as much of the neck as possible and will make hiding the joints easier. And during this shot, we let the camera slide down the rail, creating a nice push-in on the character. We also had a mark on the floor to make sure we would both be standing in the same place, and a mark on the wall as an eye line, so we would both be looking in the same direction. Next, we swapped places and clothes, and person 2, that was me, put on the rubber mask. We then repeated the same camera move and action, this time with me as person 2 pulling off the real rubber mask. We basically guessed the speed of the move and when to do it, so there were quite a few variables here, but we did several takes until we got one we thought would work. Then I did a quick check with the two best takes on a timeline with a fade between them and was happy that we couldn't really get it any better. Finally, before packing down, we filmed the same camera move with neither of us in the shot, and this would act as our clean plate to use anywhere we would need a background behind the characters. And then we were done, and it was time to blend it all together using Adobe After Effects. Now for the editing part of this tutorial, as usual, I'm just going to give a quick overview. But if you're a complete beginner or want to learn every single process I'm using from scratch in full detail, you can of course check out my After Effects Essentials course, and the link to learn more about that is below. So the first thing you can do is to line up your takes on top of each other with person 1 at the top, then person 2, and then lastly the blank background at the bottom. And now you can decide which parts to use of which takes. There is no one way of doing this effect, so you probably will need to experiment. We know it needs to end with the full finished shot of person 2, and we can now decide how much to use of person 1, either just the face, or the face and the whole body, or maybe just the face and the arm. It all depends on what works. So you can try cutting out these elements, such as the head and the arm, using the rotor brush, and then fading them in and out at different times to see what works. The rotor brush allows you to trace around the element you want to remove using a green line, and After Effects will then attempt to cut this out frame by frame, and you can make little adjustments as you go. Finally, when you're happy, you can click freeze, and that will lock in the changes and prevent it from altering it any further. We had also shot an option of person 1 not doing the move with the arm, just in case the body swap didn't work and we just had to use the face. But in the end, the body swap did work, so we used almost all of person 1 at the beginning of the shot. In the end, I cut out almost everything individually with the rotor brush, which separated them from the background, and then I could use parts of these by drawing masks over the top using the pen tool. If you choose to film the effect with a green screen instead, this will do the background removal for you, but it might make it harder to look like your subject is really in your location. However, if this doesn't bother you, then another advantage to using green screen is that you could use footage from elsewhere to create a more dramatic looking location, such as footage from our sponsor ArtGrid. This is a fantastic subscription-based royalty-free stock footage site. I use it for many professional jobs I do through my production company because they've got lots of high-quality shots and they offer unlimited downloads for one simple license and one monthly fee. The license covers everything no matter what size of project you are working on. And if you want to sign up to ArtGrid, you can use my link below this video to get 2 extra months. So whether you use green screen or rotoscope, you will end up with loads of different layers and it can become confusing quite quickly. But this does give you more choice about how to time every element changing. For the face fading through to the rubber mask underneath, the basic idea is to distort person 1's face to match the stretching motion of person 2's rubber mask underneath, and that way, if you choose to show parts of the rubber mask, everything is moving in the same way. In the past, we've tried using both the mesh warp tool and the puppet pin tool, and these are both good ways to distort an object. You could also try tools such as liquify to get a similar effect. In the end though, this time I mainly just duplicated the face layer a few times more, cut out different small parts of the face separately, and then these could be stretched slightly in different directions with the size control, and just faded at different speeds and different times to reveal parts of the rubber mask underneath. For the eyes, the best method I have found is to actually change the eyes from person 1 to person 2 before person 1's face disappears altogether. If it was a real mask, you would be seeing the eyes of person 2 through the eye holes the whole time. So you can build a separate pre-composition, which is simply the first person's eyes subtly changing to the second person's eyes. This can then be cut out to only appear as if seen through the eye holes, so that by the time the mask comes off, you're already expecting to see the second person's eyes, and that really helps the effect. So here's how the effect ended up after cutting out almost every individual element separately and fading these in and out at different times. If we add colors to the layers, you can see where each part starts and ends more easily. Person 1 is in red, person 2 is in green. So the shot begins almost fully as person 1, the hand with the gun changes to person 2 almost right away, then the face stays real as person 1 for as long as possible, and then finally changes to the rubber mask on person 2 underneath gradually in little pieces. Finally, the hand holding the mask changes during that movement, as does the rest of the body. The finishing touch was some sound design of the mask being pulled off and some suitable music. And so now we are done and it's time to look back at the finished effect. Well, if you enjoyed that and want to learn how to make the best film you can right now, then you will love my free webinar where I reveal my top 10 tips for making your passion project on a budget. It's the list I wish had existed when I was first starting out and I knew absolutely nothing. So I've put this free list together to give you some filmmaking inspiration, no matter what level you are at. There's tips on everything from scriptwriting a good idea, to pre-production and planning, to running your actual shoot where I share tips from real recent short films that I have directed, and then all the way through to post-production. So click the link below to save your spot on the free webinar, and I will see you inside. Happy movie making, and I'll see you next time.